name's Warren Miller. I'm the interim executive director of the museum and also trustee and its treasurer. And I'd like to start by acknowledging my fellow trustees who are here tonight. Bill, excuse me? Closer to the mic? Okay. My fellow trustees, Bill Burtness, Robin Schutte, George Burtness, Randy Fox, Larry Hammett and Eleanor Van Cott, John Woodward and Andy Weber. Thank you all for coming and joining us this evening. I'd also like to give a special welcome to the members of the Sansum family. Those of you who aren't familiar with the Historical Museum but would like to know more, please see me after the lecture so we can start introducing you to us. The exhibition on the walls of this sala are the works of Lockwood DeForest. It's an exhibition called Luminescent Santa Barbara. Unfortunately, it closes Sunday, but I do encourage you to take a look at the paintings afterwards if you have a minute. It's a really wonderful collection of works by a singular artist well identified with Santa Barbara. The next exhibition, which opens on March 20, is Impressions in Ink, etchings from our collection, many of which have never been publicly exhibited. So that's going to be a really special show, and I would encourage you all to make a point to come in and see it. The museum also wishes to acknowledge the generous financial support of the following toward the publication of the issue of Noticias on the Sansum Clinic, which you will receive at the as you leave this evening. They are William Burtness, the Lisa Letter Cutler Trust, Robin Schutte, and the Sansum Clinic, who sponsored the publication and the research and are co-hosts for tonight's event. Now, Dr. Kurt Ranzerhoff, the CEO and Chief Medical Officer of Sansum Clinic, one of the cornerstones of our community, providing health care that runs the gamut from pediatrics to geriatrics. Dr. Ranzerhoff oversees the largest health care delivery system in Santa Barbara County and one of the county's oldest and largest medical foundations. He joined Sansum Clinic in 1992, has been Chief Medical Officer since 97, and CEO since 2002. Dr. Ranzerhoff.
Thank you, Warren, and thanks to the members of the museum's Board of Trustees for partnering with us this evening. Tonight promises to be a fun night, and typically a fun night involving Sansum Clinic usually involves our Sansum Clinic's Women's Council, and tonight is no exception. So I'd like to thank Julie Nadell and Bobby Rosenblatt for hosting tonight's event for us. Thank you. I would like to introduce some of the Sansum Clinic volunteer trustees with us this evening. Vicki Hazard, our board chair, is here. Dr. Ron Latimer, Julie McGovern, Dr. Jim McNamara. You will hear more about Dr. McNamara and his parents from Dr. Danielle later tonight. Art Maravec, Eddie Rosenblatt, George Rusnak, and Beth Voss. Also, some administrative colleagues of mine are here. Vince Jensen, our COO and president, and Chris McNamara, our senior vice president of operations. We also have a colleague from across the street, and that is Ron Wirth, the CEO of Cottage Hospital, joined us here today. I actually mean across the street geographically. There are many controversial and dramatic things happening in healthcare, and I am excited to tell you that I won't talk about any of them tonight. Instead, it is my pleasure to introduce to you this evening's speakers, Dr. Erno Danielle and Erin Graffy, who will be speaking on Sansum Clinic, a legacy of medical innovation. Dr. Erno Danielle is an internal medicine specialist right down the hall from me. One of the first physicians in Santa Barbara certified in geriatric medicine. He's been with Sansum Clinic for 36 years. He raised his eyebrows. It's true, Erno. He is a 1964 graduate and a 2013 Wall of Fame inductee at Santa Barbara High School. So go Dons. Dr. Daniel became involved in preserving the clinic's history in 1983, which was the 200th anniversary of Santa Barbara. Manuscripts that he's edited, which relate to the clinic history, are preserved right here in this library. Erin Graffy, our other speaker, is a noted author whose work has appeared in Southern California Quarterly and Santa Barbara Magazine. She's authored several books, most recently, The Santa Barbara Yacht Club, A Waterfront History. She has written many pieces for the Noticias. So let me turn things over to our speakers, Dr. Erno Daniel and Erin Graffy.
One of the things I love about Santa Barbara is that no matter what field of endeavor you look at, anything, music, dance, aviation, right down to medicine, Santa Barbara has always put itself on the map, become the first, the second, the biggest, the fastest, whatever it is. And as we see in our medical legacy here, medicine is no exception. We've actually got this talk in kind of two parts. This is kind of fun for me. Tapped in to help on this side. The Sansum people didn't realize that when I came back home after college in the 80s, I worked at Sansum Medical Research Foundation, and that I had done a little documentary, wrote a documentary on Dr. Sansum and the research over there. And for you older timers, you might remember when you went into the clinic during the 80s, and there was a big history board on the left, right side as you came in on a big, as I recall, expensive piece of walnut that and anyway, so created that. So this was sort of very close to my heart to jump in on this. Now, one of the interesting things about our clinic is this wonderful clinic with all these amazing doctors and all the achievements, it doesn't just come out of nowhere. That there are many different themes that add into how this happened. And I think what's unique about Santa Barbara and why it spawns all this achievement in other areas is there's something in the soil and there's something in the psyche right from the beginning that lends itself to the development of all these things. So starting off in our, let's see if I got this the right side. Aha. So starting right off in the beginning, let's just take a look and see what was the groundwork that led to all of this. And we're going to jump back quickly to the 19th century. Okay, am I holding it the wrong way? Help, help. There we go. Let's take a look at Santa Barbara during the 1880s. Before all the clinic things started, Santa Barbara was on the map across the United States as a place as a health resort. Those of you who've come from the East Coast can figure out, do the math on this. You show up in the worst part of any kind of weather and it's like today, 65 degrees, and we're expecting a little rain this weekend. So it's such wonderful weather here that that was healing properties just to begin with. Then you have Dr. Brinkerhoff, I have to say it was a doctor, who back in the early 60s and 70s was saying that the offshore oil seeps and the odor that would come from that, the fumes might have a restorative nature on people's health. So healthcare has changed a little bit. And then coming into the 80s, 1880s that is, then we had in the 70s coming into it, there was the hot springs, the sulfur springs that people came and flood to healing properties in Montecito. Coming into the 80s, we had the Veronica medicinal water that was coming out of Hidden Valley. And this was a huge export long before our egg McMuffin. That was what put us on the map as far as the local product. So the medicinal healing qualities of that water. So we're already setting the stage. We come into the late 80s and we have a doctor's wife who says, you know, the town is only about 4,000, 5,000 people, but we need a hospital. Extraordinary that in a community this small that these people get together, 50 women, and they create the cottage hospital. And we move right up to the 90s when we bring in one of our chief of staff there for the hospital. We bring in a man who did the first appendectomy, there we go, in the United States. He didn't do it here, but nonetheless, we claim him because he came here. And he brought with him, or soon after, there's our cottage hospital. A little interesting, it was meant to be a series of cottages with the different specialties. However, like even today, they decided, you know, it's going to cost too much money. What if we just gang it up and make a big building? And there we go. And we have one of the first X-ray machines in the entire country was here in Santa Barbara. Unbelievable, 1896. Now, coming at the same time around the corner into the new century, on the East Coast, in New York, we have a phenomenal doctor, Nathaniel Bowditch Potter, and he's doing work in metabolic diseases, in diabetes, and in nephritis, and he's underwritten with the Carnegie Foundation. Now, at this time, we're just coming out of the industrial age. You've got these great barons of capitalism and an industry. And in America, they said, with all that wealth, we're going to reach out and see things that we can fix and improve across the country. And so they invested, the Carnegies invested in medical areas. So Dr. Bowditch under, Dr. Potter, sorry, with the Carnegie Grant is working back East Coast. And what he finds is that he himself is falling victim to several diseases, including nephritis and diabetes, and he has health problems, heart problems, as well as something else big there. I'll think of it in a second. I'm just blanking. Anyway, with that poor health, he approaches the Carnegie Foundation. He says, my own doctor says, I got to get out of New York. I got to come to the West Coast. Is it possible that we could continue to fund the good work we're doing at this clinic with all these people that we're able to see and treat? Tuberculosis, sorry, I knew there was another big one. He also had TB. He says, is it possible that we could still continue to do this and set this up, but do it on the West Coast? Carnegie says, yes. Carnegie, at that time, the board is head up by Henry Pritchett. Conveniently, Henry Pritchett has come to Santa Barbara numerous times. He stayed at the Potter Hotel, no relation. He even bought property on Unipro Plaza. And he says to Dr. Potter, not only do we think this is fine and we can move the clinic, I have the place on the West Coast that you should come to, and they set this up in Santa Barbara. Now, what they did for clinics at this time is a little different focus or different way that perception that people had of clinics back then. At this time, clinics were attached to a hospital. It was a wing of a hospital or maybe an associated building of a hospital. And the emphasis simply would have been on research and treating patients on an outpatient basis. But they were attached to a clinic and had some underlying research as part of that. So we've set up this clinic at the hospital. The clinic becomes bigger and bigger and bigger and more and more and more people so that they have to build his own clinic, and he says, I got to have a new building. The Carnegie says, we'll help out, and the local philanthropist, including Billings and Knapp. Knapp was another big industrialist, came to Santa Barbara, one of our hilltop barons, and he was very much invested in medicine, so he says, let's get this thing going. They also got Clarence Black and Frederick Peabody, and they make a Potter Metabolic Clinic, which is its own separate building. Now, so far, so good. We're around 1917, 18, and within 2 years, unfortunately, Dr. Potter dies. But you see, what we've laid the groundwork here is this tremendous amount of now philanthropic interest in the healthcare in Santa Barbara, starting with the Carnegie Foundation. Now these four philanthropists are investing in the medical research and in the hospital. Now that Dr. Potter has died, we need a replacement. How are we going to take care of this? And Knapp says, George Knapp talks to his own doctor that he brought out, and his own doctor says, I know just the man you ought to check out. His name is, there's George Knapp, is William David Sansum, and he's at Rush Medical in Chicago, and I think he's the man for you. William David Sansum was very, very interested in diabetes. He had done a lot of research already and written a lot of significant reports and books and things having to deal with journal articles dealing with diabetes. He seemed like the man. Knapp convinced him and brought him out to Santa Barbara. So he comes out here. Let's see if I've got my next. No, we're fine. So when he comes out here, he is completely invested in the Potter Metabolic Clinic, treating diabetes, researching diabetes. And at this time in the country, when different scientists and medical researchers were working on things, they were more apt to share. There wasn't so much proprietary interest as there is today. So people are a little more willing to work on this and to share some of their findings. So Sansum's working on this. This is about 1920-21. We're coming into Santa Barbara. And in the meantime, we have up in Canada, we have Drs. Banting and Best, or Dr. Frederick Banting, and Charles Best was his assistant, did not have his degree at that time. And they were working on diabetes research up there. And a word about diabetes, it was a different disease 80, 90 years ago. I can't say that in a room full of physicians. It was not a different disease. It was a different public perception of it. Sorry. Stop, reverse. Reroll the tape. Today, most of the time, what you have from the media is the concentration is on type 2 insulin insufficient diabetes, something that can be ameliorated or maybe addressed through diet. Back then, it was different. This was type 1 diabetes, as it was known, juvenile onset, insulin, nothing, completely dependent. They didn't know about the insulin yet. It was a medical mystery. A complete medical mystery. They could not figure out how this thing was working. So the researchers were trying to identify what they thought was the hormone. And to shorten up that long story, the first ones through the door are Banting's and Best. Banting and, oops, there we go. You can see how young Charles is there, the assistant. And in January of 21, they isolate insulin. They're using it from the pancreas of a dog. And it was huge news in the medical community because, as I mentioned, this is a death sentence, and now all of a sudden there's a reprieve, okay? You've got a pardon, there's more life ahead of you. And most of the time, depending on the severity of your disease at that time, juvenile onset, you could go as quickly as 2 months, or you may last as many as maybe 7 or 8 years. Alrighty, now going back to Santa Barbara, because the doctors there were sharing some of their findings, Dr. Sansum gets right on this and starts working on this just a few months after this, following the trail that they are doing. And what he is using in isolating is going after the pancreas from cows, very different. And he's working on that area. Hold on a second. And what I found was interesting was you think once they discovered something, then I would have thought then everybody can do it automatically and everybody's healed. It didn't work that way because it was difficult to get the right refinement in the insulin to produce the potent enough to get active insulin, that was it, and to get potent enough batches. So that was a lot of trial and error. A little side note here for our Santa Barbarians was we had slaughterhouses in Goleta, and then Pearl, as in Pearl Chase, closed those down. So Dr. Sansum would want to get the pancreas from the cows right after they were slaughtered because he was figuring out this is when the insulin would be more potent. So he would get up early in the morning, as in 3 o'clock, this is 1921, drive down to Los Angeles to go to the slaughterhouses there because they were all closed in Santa Barbara. As he was coming back up, interestingly, off the coast of Pacific Coast Highway, he has the pancreas in these big bins, I'm sorry, these big canisters full of alcohol, and it's prohibition. So he gets pulled over, he gets nabbed, he gets busted, and he's trying to say, but I'm a doctor, and that didn't carry a whole lot of weight. But interestingly, very soon after that, he noticed that the Assistant Secretary of State, their son had diabetes, so he contacted them and said where, blah, 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 explained the problem, and so that's why they had a medical dispensation for bringing in that kind of alcohol, and he would get special license, and it would be shipped down from San Francisco to Santa Barbara. But as I'd heard from some of the old-timers, one of those canisters came into Santa Barbara from San Francisco. There was always a few inches missing from the top. So, we're here in Santa Barbara, and in May, just within 5 weeks after, actually about 4 or 5 months after Banting and Best in Canada, and about 4 or 5 weeks after Dr. Sansum gets interested in this, he does produce it successfully in Santa Barbara. Put Santa Barbara on the map. It's the first place in the United States where someone has developed and produced insulin and successfully treated an American citizen. Let's see. So we see that insulin is discovered by the Canadian doctors and that they're getting success here at the Potter Metabolic Clinic. So this is where we come up to and we've put ourselves on the map. Accolades all over the place for Sansum. And then it becomes a flood of people that come to Santa Barbara to be treated for diabetes. And what's interesting on this is the ramifications of this. Not only does Dr. Sansum help or ameliorate the condition for diabetics all over the United States, at this time there was probably about 500,000 diabetics. This is would be type 1, and that how their lives are changed, you know, wonderfully. But there's other ramifications, because by about 3 or 4 degrees of separation, Sansum also changed the face of Santa Barbara. When he did this discovery of insulin, there was a man in Mission Canyon. He headed up the Museum of Natural History. His name was Ralph Hoffman, and he had a niece, little 9-year-old niece, who was diabetic. So you can imagine that he contacted his brother, because the niece and the brother lived back east, and said, Santa Barbara, you need to come out here. So the father comes out here. The daughter is treated by Dr. Sansum. This is, by the way, by far the youngest patient. The others were struggling along. They might have been her teens, 20s, 30s. The oldest was a 48-year-old. However, what happens is the daughter is treated successfully here, or gets her diabetes under control. The family lives here for several years and then goes back at the end of the 20s. But while he was here, the little girl's father was Bernard Hoffman. And so you know his name is the one who teamed up with Pearl Chase, and after the earthquake and changing to our architectural standards, style of the Spanish Revival. So that's just some of the ramifications of why we're here. Going back to our story, we find that Sansum has written up all of the United States. He draws the attention of all the papers, and just one of the fun here is the Hearst editor, Arthur Brisbane, who calls Sansum Santa Barbara's genius. All righty, so we're doing the clinic at the Potter Clinic at Cottage. We have the 1925 earthquake, which literally shakes things up. A lot of problems with Cottage Hospital because of the damage and cleaning that up. And by now, we start to have the commercially produced insulin so that Dr. Sansum isn't dependent. People aren't depending on just coming here to Santa Barbara to be treated by Dr. Sansum, although he's continuing in this edge. As they're finishing this up, what they determine is that they are going to cut loose the Potter Metabolic Clinic, that it will not be funded through Cottage Hospital, it will also not be funded with the Carnegie funding has now ended. So Dr. Sansum's thinking, what in the world am I going to do? And we go back to our philanthropist, George Owen Knapp, and he says, well, why don't you open your own clinic? And he says, own clinic? How would I go about doing that? Well, Dr. Knapp happens to have a piece of property, and it is directly across the street from Cottage Hospital. He was already setting up an office on the corner for his own doctor, and now he says to Dr. Sansum, I'll back you. I've got the property. We'll put this together, and they do. So they set up the next, I'm ahead of myself. So they set up the clinic across the street. At this time, I just consider the 1920s really the golden era of Santa Barbara on so many levels, and one, of course, is architecture. So Knapp doesn't just build a building. He brings in one of the top architects, Carlton Windsor, and he's the one who designs the clinic. At this time, Sansum is also bringing in other doctors to work with him, and one of the favorite, his best buddies, was Dr. Hildal Burtness, who had come from back east, a foreign country, I think Minnesota, something like that. And what I always remember was I did know, and I did work briefly before he died with Dr. Burtness, and he said he came out here on, I think it was June 29th, 1929. It was the day that they stopped running the streetcars. So I always remember that date or something close to it. So they build the new clinic, and this is what it looked like right across the street from the Cottage Hospital. After the clinic is built, it's very soon thereafter that we go into the Depression. Now, the significant part about this is that this clinic is built around a personality. It's built towards research on a very specific area. And so when they are going into the Depression, it's very hard to carry all the staff because it is this one man's clinic. So he has to let some of the doctors go. They have to make some changes in order to keep the clinic barely alive during this very difficult time. And that brings us up into the war era. I'm just sort of shortening these parts just to show the development here. We finished the Depression, we go into the war era, and right after, we had a lot of doctors having to leave town to obviously serve the cause. Dr. Sansum dies a few years after the end of World War II, and now the problem is, how are we going to continue this clinic? Are we going to be able to keep it as this corporation, or is it going to just have it, the family sell it off? And what they decide is, the group of the doctors that were there is, let us not dissolve the clinic as a corporation. Why don't we buy this out and keep this going? And one of the Sansum physicians, I'm going to start with the female just because that's different. Dr. Doris McNamara, she was the wife of another physician from Sansum, which was Dr. Delbert McNamara, and they were the parents of Dr. James McNamara. And it was their work, working with some of the other doctors, to continue that. And other doctors at this time, of course, included Dr. Burtness, Dr. Jim Saint, Alfred Kohler, and Dugo McDowell, I'm sorry, to continue the corporation. The one thing that war did, of all the terrible things that war does, people say, well, what good does comes out of war? There's one thing that does come good out of war, and that is medical innovation and technology. After every major war, the things that come out of that are quite, unfortunately, because of the war, but nonetheless, pretty astounding. World War II, of course, would have been penicillin, getting that out into the civilian use from that, and some of the new fields, such as neurology, closed head wounds, open head wounds, and addressing that. And from the war, after this, we're going into the baby boomers, the growth of the population, into the 1950s, and coming from the war, because of these different new areas, new specialties are coming into medicine. And in fact, the whole field of specialization is changing. Whereas before this, it was the general practitioner, and specialization back in the 20s was maybe 17% of all the doctors. Now we find in the 1950s that about 74% of the medical school graduates have a specialization. A very, very different change. And there's a couple of different reasons for that that Erno will be addressing as well. So now as we come into the 50s and leaving the 50s, we have the expansion of the population. And with that, at Sansum, curiously, is a huge increase of out-of-town population. And there was a couple of reasons for this. One is, after the war, people feel that they have more of a worldwide view, and they're not afraid to travel to get services and things that they need, and that includes medicine. And the other thing was happening over in Las Vegas. Las Vegas is just getting built up in the 40s, and there is nothing there but people just starting to do these casinos and maybe some stores. There's no medical care. So one of the guys who was a developer in Las Vegas came to Santa Barbara to have his medical checkup and everything else, and he loved his experience so much that he went back and told everybody in Las Vegas, come to Santa Barbara. So that's why, at that time, about 66.2% of the Sansum Clinic patient population was from out of town. Las Vegas was 10% of the patient load alone. And with the baby boomers and all this expansion, obviously we grow out of space, and that takes us up to our modern era. Oops, we forgot Dr. Delbert. We take it up to our modern era. You might recognize a lot of the people up there. Let's see, there's Dr. Casey Doms. I don't know all of them. I think that's Dr. McNeese. There's Dr. Merritt. Oh, there we got Hildal Burtness right there. Dr. McNamara, and is this, I think, the other Dr. McNamara. And we also have a brand new clinic built to accommodate now the growth of the baby boomers and what's happening. This takes up pretty much to our modern times. But continuing that spirit of where Sansum was founded, with the singular-minded and individual, which is going to be different when we get to our second half, and emphasis on research, a lot of the doctors at this time, even through up to the 80s when I was there, a lot of them like to keep that one foot in the door of the laboratory. So the Medical Research Foundation was separated in 1948, a separate entity, but still some of the physicians at the clinic liked doing some work over there. Just some of the ones I can mention was Dr. Casey Doms, who did work in bone marrow for patients with an immune deficiency, Lowell Sparks testing some of the drugs for some of the oral agents for diabetes. Two very prominent cytologists, worldwide famous, Dr. Francis and Mariana Mason, were doing work at this time. And I just found out recently, are they here by any chance? They're still alive. They're in Carpinteria, so they've been there with the around this town for 70, 80 years. And Dr. Lowenthal and many of the physicians involved there. So the last part of our crucial part of our story is we're going into a little bit of a change. And I will be just about to turn this over, and Dr. Daniels is going to kind of bring us up to speed on the other half. But to take us back, going back to the 1920s, just briefly, or 1900 to 1920s, the population in Santa Barbara tripled. And matching that was what was happening in our medical thing. We added on St. Francis Hospital, the visiting nurses. Of course, we had the Potter Clinic. And getting these new facilities, and the change that was happening here, a lot of that going on in America. We talked about the philanthropists such as Carnegie investing in medicine and looking at ways to improve people's lives, and they came out, Carnegie Contra commissioned a study done on medical and how could we improve that, and that this Flexner report was something that spoke to what was lacking in the medical profession, and that was standardization and good education. It was kind of like somebody could just go off and do a really good school and somebody else could just do a, I don't know, you could just see the ads. Suit yourself. Become a brain surgeon in your own spare time. You know, how I made millions out of my own living room. So what they were suggesting was there needs to be standardization. We need to have an impetus to bringing about organized medicine, and this is the change that we'll be talking about. And we see that the difference that Sansum has an individual vision and that the Santa Barbara Clinic is going to have a different vision in mind. And how that came about, to tell more of our story, I'm going to bring up my colleague. I like saying colleague because he's an MD and a PhD. And Dr. Daniels, I know that you would like to bring us on the other half of the story and our and the wrap-up for Sansum.
Thank you, Erin. Well, here goes the rest of the story. And this brings us to the Santa Barbara Clinic because, as many of you know, in fact, there were two clinics that ran parallel until 1998 when the two large clinics that were here in Santa Barbara merged. And there was Sansum Clinic and the Santa Barbara Clinic, and they were really two separate but parallel entities that worked side by side to take care of patients in Santa Barbara. And at this point, our clinic, the current clinic, is really came from the fusion of the two, and that's what makes a very interesting story. My own involvement, I went to high school locally, and then when I first came back to the clinic in 1978, I became dictating roommates with Dr. Vern Friedel. We used to dictate our notes after patient visits. And his father was one of the original seven doctors, one of the original four associates that were hired in 1921 to the Santa Barbara Clinic. And I believe he came from Rush Medical College in Chicago, just like Dr. Sansum did, and a lot of the other physicians in 1921 came. And so Vern Friedel knew all these stories, including some of the stories that are not supposed to go in the official history books about what all happened in the 1920s. So we had a lot of fun talking about old histories from the 20s and 30s. And also, several of the wives of the original founders were still alive at that time. So Santa Barbara was 200 years old in 1983. That was the 200-year anniversary of founding the Presidio, you know, just across the street here. And Professor Kelly from UCSB, whose father used to have Kelly's Corner, the grocery store up at Five Points, became professor of history at UCSB. And one of his graduate students collaborated with us at Santa Barbara Clinic to write the official history of the Santa Barbara Clinic, and it was actually a master's thesis. So it was very well written, formally written, researched, annotated, and the whole thing. And so I was involved in that. And a couple of one-liners. I actually wrote the prologue, the foreword, and the epilogue to the volume. And the headers that I put on to my comments were a couple of quotes. One is, "The best thing which we derive from history is the enthusiasm that it raises in us." I really felt reading the medical histories, or the local medical history, really was something that would raise a lot of enthusiasm. Real world history has lots of terrible chapters that one is not proud of or not enthusiastic about, but generally medical history is a lot of interesting, positive things that we can get enthusiastic about. So that was my impression also, my impression of the Santa Barbara Clinic and Santa Barbara's medical history in general. At the same time, in the epilogue, my header was, "We're always looking to the future. The present does not satisfy us. Our ideal, whatever it may be, lies further on." And I think that was also a fitting motto for the physicians who came to Santa Barbara, who were always forward-looking, always trying to push things ahead, both on the science front, as also the healthcare front, and just in every way, including the civic front. And I think this is sort of what characterizes my involvement with local history and local medical history, and that's why I consider it a lot of fun to be part of it. Now, from my perspective, medicine rests on three pillars, and the three pillars are medical science, healthcare delivery, and the financing of healthcare. And even today in the media, these three issues are jumbled together. Somebody will say, "We have the best healthcare system in the world because we have the best medical research." Well, medical research is not healthcare. In the same way, when they talk about healthcare and healthcare is going to be denied and whatever, it's not healthcare that's denied, it's the financing of healthcare that may be denied. Insurance may be denied. So again, people don't separate these three, even though they're really three things that really are separate entities, but you need to have all three side by side to actually have healthcare delivery and healthcare systems as such. And the remarkable thing is that in Santa Barbara, all these three things got cobbled together, and that's why we have the current clinic and the current healthcare system we have in town, which most of us believe are probably exceptional for the size of the community we're in. Now, clinic, hospital, and medical practitioners. So what makes these three pillars of modern medicine work? Well, a clinic or a hospital is just an empty building. If you don't have people in it, you got nothing. It's just a big empty building. Likewise, if you have a medical office building, that's just an office building where a bunch of people can rent an office, and there really is no system to it. It's just private practitioners rent an office, and that's that. And when they leave, that office is vacant. Somebody else comes in, rents that office. So just having a building, a clinic building, or a hospital building doesn't really give scientific medicine, doesn't give healthcare delivery, doesn't give the financing of healthcare. So who makes the system work? Well, ultimately it's people. Without people you won't have anything happening. And since 1921, the remarkable thing here has been that the two clinics between them and Cottage Hospital have brought several hundred physicians to Santa Barbara who were really people of incredible diversity and incredible education and talent, a really wealth of talent and a pool of talent. As Erin pointed out, Dr. Burtness came from Minnesota. My wife is from Minnesota. She's proud of Minnesota heritage. And, physicians who came from over half of the states of the United States, several foreign countries, and they all brought their perspective, they all brought their education, and some of them were really remarkably well-educated individuals with remarkable perspectives, and that began in 1921. So that was really the backdrop of where we came from. In fact, by 1940, when a particular physician died, the Santa Barbara Morning Press had the following editorial. So they also recognized that in Santa Barbara, we have been fortunate in having an unusually large group of medical men, some women, with sufficient character to impress themselves on the public at all times, not only through proficiency and unselfishness in their professional life, but through their interest in activities and civic affairs. One of the outstanding members in this group has been Dr. Rexwell Brown. His devotion to the cause of preventive medicine and public health has made him a national figure. Who was Dr. Brown? Anybody ever hear of Dr. Brown? All right, well, I guess we need to backtrack. So who were the three local pillars, you know, of the pillars that we need to actually do healthcare delivery, you know, as a system? Well, medical science, as we heard, Dr. Sansum clearly was the quintessential medical scientist who delved into basic science issues, hired chemists, extracted insulin, produced insulin, wrote papers, and organized a group of physicians around this idea to be primarily a diabetes center, which did primarily internal medicine for many, many years, and their focus was diabetes and research and the care of diabetic patients. But if you look back at Sansum Clinic, they did not deliver babies. Okay, they did not do surgery for many years after the founding of the clinic. It was primarily an internal medicine consultative science group that was not necessarily prepared to take care of the community. In fact, as Erin mentioned, even 1960-ish, two-thirds of the patients were coming from out of town. So they were really more focused on the science of medicine and doing exceptional scientific medical work as opposed to necessarily being a community resource. Remarkably comes Dr. Rexel Brown, who in 1921, exact same time as Dr. Sansum, comes to head the Potter Metabolic Clinic, opens his own group and his colleagues, and their entire focus is healthcare delivery, and I'll come to that here in a second. And in the background is George Owen Knapp, who we already heard some mention of, who was head of Union Carbide in Chicago. He was from Chicago and believed best doctors in the country were all from Rush Medical College, so anytime he wanted a physician to do good work in Santa Barbara, he would go back to Chicago and bring somebody from Rush Medical College, including Dr. Sansum and several others. And he was doing a lot of the financing of the healthcare institutions. At the same time, we need to remember that financiers don't finance healthcare, especially these days. Who finances healthcare? Government? Government programs? Insurance companies? No, I mean, there would be no insurance company unless citizens paid into an insurance plan, and the government couldn't finance anything unless taxpayers pay taxes, because without that, I mean, they can print money for a while, but that doesn't, and they sort of do that, but that doesn't last for very long. So basically, ultimately, citizens and people of the country finance healthcare ultimately, but having benefactors who really push things along, you know, obviously makes a huge difference. Audience is Charlie Schneider, who is friend and patient of the clinic, who just did sort of a very interesting research on George Owen Knapp and his involvement in the community. As many of you know, there's Knapp Drive and Knapp's Castle up on top of the hill and Knapp College of Nursing. So he was really a remarkable individual. And like I said, some local research has been done on his career and his activities. Now, this is Dr. Rex Brown, looks like a determined kind of a guy, and actually it occurred to me that this picture of him looks a little bit like Harry Houdini. I don't know if you've ever seen a picture of Harry Houdini, but he looks very determined. He doesn't look like sort of, you know, the guy you want to sit down with and, you know, sort of pour your heart out for some medical issue. He was a surgeon, and he was extremely determined to do certain things a certain way, had some very strong beliefs, and he wrote those and put those into action. But this is Rex Brown. His story was, and I have the dates a little bit mixed, he actually started out serving in the Spanish-American War in the United States Marines in 1898, then came back and went to Northwestern University Medical School, where he finished actually in 1903. That was the same medical school where one of the two Mayo brothers went. That was in Chicago. So Chicago had Rush College of Medicine and Northwest University Medical School. And again, I believe Charlie Mayo, one of the two, went to Northwestern University Medical School. He then went to work for the Armour meatpacking family, and they brought him out to Santa Barbara, of all things. He was married at the time. I think his wife may have had some health issues. 1906, he arrives in Santa Barbara. Santa Barbara's population is at most 15,000 people. Begins to write articles, yearly articles, or a couple a year, on surgical topics, Rex Brown's clinic and at Cottage Hospital. He's writing medical articles when Santa Barbara is literally smaller than Carpinteria is today. He's writing medical articles and is in contact with colleagues in Chicago and elsewhere. 1910 is when the Flexner Report comes out, which is not lost on Rex Brown, which formalizes medical education and the principles of medical education, that scientific education is crucial to medicine of the future. And in 1914, about the time World War I breaks out and he has to go back to the service, Mayo Brothers announce that they are establishing an integrated multi-specialty group practice model in Rochester, Minnesota. So Mayo Clinic had already been in place, or Dr. Mayo, the original William Worrell Mayo, was practicing in Minnesota since 50 years earlier. But actually, the two Mayo brothers, the younger Mayo brothers, transformed their practice into an integrated multi-specialty group practice model that was very deliberate, very carefully thought out, and was to become a model of what made the Mayo Clinic work. This was not lost on Dr. Brown, who also went to Northwestern like one of the Mayo brothers, and when he came back from World War I, he decided that the military way of doing multi-specialty or subspecialty medicine was the way to go. Where if you had a belly injury, you went to the belly surgeon. If you had a hand injury, you went to the hand surgeon. If you had head injury, you went to the head surgeon. And this was sort of unheard of in private practice, but he really believed that this was the way to go. And he already knew that the Mayo brothers also believed strongly in this way of practicing medicine. So he convinced Giorgio Onnep to sponsor a building at 1421 State Street in Santa Barbara, and with two others started the Santa Barbara Clinic. And again, morning press, Santa Barbara Clinic opened. This was 1921, January 23rd. Doctors to practice as a group after the plan employed at Rochester, Minnesota by the Mayo brothers. And the clinic opened, and this was parallel to Sansum, who was just beginning to do the diabetes research activities. Later on, after many, many years of writing and organizing and promoting this idea of subspecialty and multi-specialty medicine and integrated medicine and group practice, Rex Brown was so well known from his writings that he was invited to be on President Roosevelt's Economic Security Commission, when only one of 11 physicians from around the country to be invited to be the medical advisory board for Social Security. He did not do this completely alone, had two partners, Hilmar Kofod, internal medicine. He was man of the year in Santa Barbara in the 1960s due to his many contributions to local causes. Benjamin Bakewell was a physician who was one of the founders of the Quisisano Sanitarium that later became St. Francis Hospital. He was a local physician. And we had East, West, and Midwest. Bakewell was Santa Barbara. I think his father was deacon at one of the local churches. Kofod, I believe, was from the Midwest originally, but did his studies at Harvard University. And of course, Rex Brown came from Northwestern University in the Midwest. And so we had, you know, again, the entire spectrum of the country contributing to starting this group. This is Dr. Kofod. I don't know if anybody from his family is here, but he has still some grandchildren here in Santa Barbara. Lloyd Butler is their family name. Dr. Brown did not have any descendants. Bakewell has had some family still here in Santa Barbara. So these were the three founders. He was the gynecologist, Kofod was the internist, and Brown was the surgeon, and they hired a urologist, a gastroenterologist, Dr. Friedel, Profant, an ear, nose, throat physician. Profant's son taught at City College. And anyway, they started the clinic with seven doctors in a building that was financed by Giorgio Onnep. This was the original San Marcos building where they started an office before they got their own building. This went down partly during the earthquake in 25. This is again Giorgio Onnep, who sort of was asked to finance everything. I proposed to my wife that I would wear an outfit like this for tonight, but she... She voted, I think, for the more traditional. But I mean, Giorgio Onnep knew a lot more about big league stuff than I did. So I mean, if he thought this was really cool, and again, Giorgio Onnep, as I mentioned, thought that Chicago was the place to do medical training, and Rush College was the place to come from. So anyway, they opened the building in 1921. And interestingly, the building is still there. It's now a law office rather than a medical office, but it's still there. But the emblem and the plaques are in place to this day. And if you look at the building, this was the original building for the seven doctors and associates. And it did say Santa Barbara Clinic up here on the lintel or whatever it's called. Just, you know, a small building with a long hall and then the offices. Within a few years, this was the entrance. They added a second story to it. So this is the same building. If you look at it, these are the two windows and the original doors. And then they built on top of it. And this was the Santa Barbara Clinic building until 1966 when they moved out to the current location out near San Marcos Pass Road. And if you go by today, look up here. This emblem has an SB and a C around it. That's Santa Barbara Clinic. And the four emblems here have Latin inscriptions. And the Latin inscriptions say, Ars Medica, the art of medicine, chirurgia, surgery, Ars Obstetrica, you know, the art of obstetrics, and radiologia, radiology. And those are still the emblems on the building, even though it's a law office. It's kind of an odd set of inscriptions for a law office, but there it is. They kept it because you're not supposed to, it's a building of historic merit, so they're not supposed to tinker with it or tamper with it. And the motto for the group was Integritas Concordia and Industria, integrity, collaboration, and industriousness. So that was Brown's motto. In fact, he felt so strongly about all these issues that he and his partners put together an official Declaration of Principles, 1936. As many of you know, the Great Depression hit in the meanwhile, and within 8 years of starting the clinics, both Sansum and Santa Barbara Clinics, Great Depression hit, and a lot of stuff was going under, including Giorgio and Knapp's finances. So the financial backing of the clinics were in huge jeopardy, and so these groups needed to really pull together through thick and thin and try to make things work. So one of the responses was, rather than slacking off or disbanding the operation, they worked for less and they worked harder, and they became even more focused on organization. And this was the Declaration of Principles, 1936, and this could be very good declaration for today. Practice of medicine and surgery is ever growing more intricate and complicated, and whereas it's beyond the powers of a single individual to become thoroughly familiar with its various phases and keep abreast of the constant new developments in its various branches, and whereas it is evident that our patrons, the public, have a right to receive care and receive treatment consonant with the newer knowledge at a price within their economic ability to pay, Be it therefore resolved that the Santa Barbara Clinic be and is organized as a group of physicians and surgeons trained in a special fields, each dependent upon the other for the correlation of diagnoses and treatment, so that in effect the whole body of the group will constitute a single unit, a magnified family doctor with the mind and activity of many, but the purpose and effect of one. And we believe that this is still the Constitution, you know, that sort of drives the clinic and sort of holds the group of physicians together who believe in this approach to doing medicine. Teamwork, team spirit, and working towards a common good for the greater benefit of the community. And the remarkable thing is, I mean, this was written in 1936. And obviously, Dr. Brown was struggling with the financing of healthcare delivery, you know, to make scientific medicine available to the public, you know, in a way that they will get the latest in medical science, but somehow still consonant with their ability to pay. All right, things then evolved fairly rapidly. World War II time, or soon thereafter, Dr. Sansom's died, Dr. Rex Brown died, Sansom's, you know, Hilda Burtness and the McNamara's reorganized the clinic group. The Santa Barbara Clinic was also continued and partly reorganized. They got through the Great Depression, World War II. A lot of the younger doctors were drafted. Off they went. Dr. Bakewell, the gynecologist, was checking sore throats on the pilots who were out at the airfield, the Marine airfield out in Goleta, because they didn't want to go to their own doctor because they'd get grounded if they were sick. So they'd come into city and have Dr. Bakewell, the gynecologist, fix their sore throat so they could continue flying. So that was World War II. Got through that and then got into the 50s, and physicians were coming back, and all of a sudden, even though in 1921 there were already ear, nose, throat, and a gastroenterologist and whatever, but now there were cardiologists and specialty surgeons and so 1950s the Santa Barbara Clinic began hiring, you know, the various specialties and beginning to build. Early 1960s, when Dr. Kofod decided to retire, he was the last of the three original founding partners, and actually the original founders owned 51% of the clinic's properties and the clinic building down on State Street. So actually Dr. Kofod then took the 51% share. So the clinic needed to do something different. There were several young surgeons who were really remarkable people, Dr. Bill Doan, McKittrick, Gephardt, Greer, you may have heard some of these names. They decided to then take a fresh look, a fresh start. Bill Doan became head of the American Group Practice Association, and again, based on the same very strong principles of collaborative work and a group practice of physicians, they decided to reorganize the clinic. They refinanced the buildings, and they moved the building out to the current location, you know, the Santa Barbara Clinic location. Near San Marcos Pass at Posadas Lane, this was the building they built. Again, in deference to the Mayo Clinic roots and the Minnesota roots, this building was designed by Ellerbe and Company, which was a company in St. Paul, Minnesota that built medical buildings. And so again, it's got a little bit of Minnesota touch to it, among other things. Supposedly the plumbing is several feet underground to protect against permafrost. So. Genuinely, the plumbers come out, they said, who the hell buried the plumbing halfway to China here? At least that's the story I've heard. I don't know if it's true, but it makes a good story. Now, this was, by the way, during World War II, there was the Hof General Hospital. This is currently the municipal golf course. This is what the municipal golf course looked like in World War II. It was a large military evacuation hospital, and the current National Guard Armory that's on the corner of Las Positas and State Street is sort of the last remnant of that. This was decommissioned, and a couple of the commanding physician officers joined the Santa Barbara Clinic. All right, Medicare kicked in 1966. Before that, there was no Medicare. So again, healthcare insurance began kicking in the 60s. Medicare was the big first serious health insurance plan that people needed to adapt to. And the clinic went ahead and went with the flow and began seeing Medicare patients or patients under Medicare insurance. As these young surgeons and physicians who took over the clinic in the late 50s were looking at things, they also decided that having the clinic as a privately owned entity where people would need to buy in and buy out of the real estate, or the physician owners would need to do that, was not a good idea. They again looked partly at the Mayo Clinic, decided to convert the whole thing into a not-for-profit foundation, and in the early 1970s, with some legal help, the Santa Barbara Clinic was turned into a not-for-profit foundation that was to be here for the benefit of Santa Barbara, benefit of the public, and physicians had no ownership. It was to be administered by a local board of trustees, and that's been the model ever since, and that's been the clinic pretty much ever since the early 1970s. About that time, the clinic also decided to go to the patients it served, so established branches in Carpinteria, Lompoc, Santa Maria. Prepaid health care plans came in through UCSB, HealthNet, and again, the clinic decided to offer those plans. And eventually, the two clinics that were going side by side began to look more and more like one another. Sansum Clinic began to grow into more of a multi-specialty model, whereas Santa Barbara Clinic continued the multi-specialty model as per the Mayo brothers since 1921. And the two clinics finally officially merged in 1998 and have been the clinic ever since that time. More recently, the clinic has established partnership with other local healthcare entities. There's been a recent partnership with the Cancer Foundation, and also there are discussions about other partnerships with Cottage Hospital and various healthcare entities. In the meanwhile, the clinic was headed by some really interesting people. Hugh Greer was a neurologist at Santa Barbara Clinic. I believe he was a Navy SEAL in underwater demolition. Did some bad things, then did some good things for helping patients and diving medicine and all that. Remarkable guy, and again, just lots of remarkable specialists who are all detailed in the book. Traditional Medical Progress. So this was the book Professor Kelly's grad student wrote, and this is in the library here, and I believe also Santa Barbara Libraries. So if you're interested in more details about the Santa Barbara Clinic and all the doctors that have ever worked there, there it is. This was the staff of Asclepius, you know, medical symbols. There's Caduceus, which is not the official symbol of medicine. That's the that's the symbol of the Army Medical Corps. The official symbol of doctors is the staff of Asclepius, where the snake comes to life, okay, and provides life. So it's the staff of the ancient physician god Asclepius. So this is the official symbol of the medical profession, as opposed to Caduceus, which, like I said, is the military symbol. In the meanwhile, clinic also depended on or benefited greatly from benefactors such as Edward Reichenbohr, who was a retired chemist, lived in Montecito, gave over $1.5 million to build an extra pavilion onto the original clinic building. And again, some of these donations were remarkably helpful in allowing the clinic to expand and to buy new equipment and do things that otherwise would not have been able to do just out of patient payments. In the meanwhile, this Mayo tradition was still in the background, I truly believe. And in one of the handouts, hand that out, or you're going to get a recent article. Mayo Clinic is 150 years old this year. They just wrote up an article called The Enduring Culture of Mayo Clinic. And it's really remarkable to read as to how they evolved and what their principles are. What is it that made their clinic what it is today? And their basic principles in the article that you can take home and read outlines that their principles are, A, the needs of the patient come first, two, the power of intrinsic motivation. Their physicians are on salary. Whether they see twice as many patients or half as many patients, they get salaried. And at the same time, all their physicians are intrinsically driven to do stuff. See patients, advance things, do medical science. They select or attract the type of physician who has intrinsic motivation. They have shared governance. All of the departments are run by physicians with an administrative helper, but they are physician-driven. And team-based medicine is their principle, as it has been since 1921 or 1914. And finding the right teammates, they put great value in selecting physicians that they bring on board, and the legacy of being able to attract funding. So Mayo Clinic really is one of the best recognized names in the United States, I think better than in many academic centers, and you know, up there with Harvard University. So they really are a remarkable healthcare institution, and we hope to be the junior partners of Mayo, in a sense, or we hope to be the little brother. You know, they were the two big Mayo brothers in 1914. We hope to be sort of the little brother that's in the process of growing up. Our goal is also unchanging. This is now for the total clinic, both Sansum, Santa Barbara Clinic, and everything that we do is to remain a comprehensive, full-service, continuously operated, locally governed, not-for-profit, multi-specialty healthcare organization and medical center, functioning as a community and regional resource with excellence in medical treatment and healthcare. The intent is to serve patients with all healthcare needs and healthcare plans, and with operations overseen by a local board of trustees. Closing quotes, these were all written by Dr. Rex Brown, and if you look at the dates, some of these dates are remarkable. 1926, 1921, 1931. Highest ideal of medicine is the promotion of individual, community, and national health. Collaboration between the people and the medical profession is essential to the real accomplishment of scientific medicine's greatest aim, health promotion. The great outstanding problem before the medical profession is that involved in the delivery of adequate scientific medical service to all people, rich and poor, at a cost which can be reasonably met by them and their respective stations in life. It was written in 1931. Little ideal sort of off into the sunset, and the rest is history, as they say. Let us liken our ideals to a brightly burning lamp, which each will tend diligently so that it may ever shine brighter, and lighting the way to the realization of our vision, more complete and successful, Sansum Clinic in Santa Barbara, justifying its existence by usefulness and the cause of modern practice of medicine. Appreciate your coming, appreciate you listening. I know it's a lot of story, and I could have talked for about 3-4 hours, so you're very lucky I did the short version.
Thank you, Erin, and thank you, Erno. I was just reflecting on some of the pictures, and some have show how much things have changed. For those of you familiar with the Posadas building, the little tree, if you, the next time you drive by, that little tree is huge now, which is really just something to look at. The picture of Mrs. Dr. McNamara with the 20 guy doctors around her, I think the clinic female-male doctor ratio is pretty close to 1-to-1, and certainly a lot closer to 1-to-1 than 1-to-20. We still have probably the largest endocrine practice, diabetes practice, between San Francisco and Los Angeles. We have, I think, over more than 10,000 diabetic patients in our care now. And still about 20% of our patients come from hither and yon. So a lot of the old traditions survive. One of the things I was really impressed with is how cool old doctors look in pictures. And I'm going to have to dispatch our marketing people to get me one of those dive suits, because I think I'd look pretty good in that. I'm going to switch gears, and I'm going to introduce George, Bill, and Bob Burtness, their father, Hildal, who we heard about earlier. And I've learned tonight that Hildal is a Norwegian name, but I guess he went by Bert. Was a physician at Sansum Clinic for 53 years. I was trying to figure out if he went to medical school and elementary school at the same time in order to have a 53-year career. But I suspect he did the traditional route. He worked with Dr. Sansum from 1930 to 1948, and the brothers will share the story of Dr. Sansum and their father. All three brothers were born at Cottage Hospital, fittingly enough, and all three attended Santa Barbara High School, another success there. Burtness Auditorium at Cottage is named after their father. All left the area for college, each choosing a different career path. George had a career at Silicon Valley and managed real estate for his alma mater, Stanford, where he went for undergrad and got an MBA. Bill also attended Stanford and also got an MBA there, and then embarked on a 31-year career in banking. Bob also got several degrees, attending Claremont and then Cal Poly, and spent 30 years as a teacher in Santa Barbara Secondary School, and has been giving back to the community for the last 15 years as a substitute teacher. All three brothers have served on various boards in Santa Barbara, including the Sansum Diabetes Research Institute. George was the chair of the Board of Trustees, as was his father. George and Bill are currently on the board here at the Historical Museum, and Bill is in fact the president. So please, George, please join me in welcoming the Burtness brothers.
Can you hear me all right? Well, thank you, Dr. Ranzelhoff, for that nice introduction. I've been asked to make a few comments on our father's relationship with Dr. William Sansum, which dates back to 1930. In that year, our father, who had just completed his medical training at Cottage Hospital, was invited by Dr. Sansum to join his medical group, which was about to move into a newly constructed state-of-the-art building on West Pueblo Street opposite Cottage Hospital. I think you there was a slide of that building earlier. I think that's about where the clinic parking lot is today. Thus began a professional association that was to span 18 years, toward the end of which the mentor was to become the patient due to Dr. Sansum's declining health. Their relationship was a special one. Despite the difference in their ages, they had much in common. Both had grown up on farms in the Midwest, Dr. Sansum in Wisconsin and Dad in Minnesota. Both attended the same medical school in Chicago, Rush. and both loved the outdoors. And when time allowed, they would gather a group of friends for a few days of fishing in the high Sierras. As has been mentioned, Dr. Sansum was a pioneer in the treatment of diabetes, and in the early 1920s was processing and administering insulin from his own laboratory, the first to do so in the United States. This, of course, was before insulin was commercially available and attracted diabetes sufferers to his clinic from far and wide. One thing that I always want to mention about Dr. Sansum is what he accomplished in a relatively short period of time. He was in his mid-30s before he completed medical school, so he practiced only about 31 or 32 years, and yet his accomplishments were extraordinary. Dr. Sansum's achievements were an inspiration to our father, who made diabetes care an important part of his own medical practice. Although he left us 66 years ago, Dr. William Sansum's legacy lives on and is being appropriately recognized this evening. Thank you. And now Brother Bob has a few remarks about the Sansum family.
A few remarks, and I'm constrained by time. Therefore, I'm going to rely on my teleprompter. I hope that's all right with you, and I'll try to maintain a little eye contact. Burtness Brothers. I've never heard that term very much. Sort of reminds me of the Marx Brothers and the Mills Brothers. However, I don't think we're very good entertainers. Anyway, here are a few thoughts I put together recently. 1929 is a well-remembered for the historic Wall Street stock market crash. But how many of us recall this was also a year of pioneering firsts, such as the comic strip character Popeye, the Academy Awards, 7-Up, the car radio, penicillin, and the public phone booth? Far less known about 1929 is the fact that our father journeyed over Route 66 in his 1926 Model T Ford coupe from Chicago to Santa Barbara to begin a residency at the Cottage Hospital in order to learn more about diabetes from Dr. William Sansum, the first one to administer insulin manufactured in the United States. By the way, the streetcars stopped running in Santa Barbara on the day after Dad arrived. He always wondered if he had something to do with that. During the following year, just before the effects of the Great Depression hit Santa Barbara, Dr. Sansum offered Dad a position at his clinic, which had a staff of about six physicians. This is how my brothers and I, for better or worse, stand before you today. The first Sansum family member I met was Dr. Sansum himself. He and Dad, who later became his personal physician, enjoyed fishing trips to destinations such as June and Steelhead Lakes in the Sierras. This is probably why he knitted the wool socks, a gift to our father, on display here. Apparently, knitting socks and sweaters was a form of therapy that Dr. Sansum used during clinic staff meetings and even while dictating letters. Yes. He had a two-track mind, or more. Also on display is a pocket watch he used while working on a railroad in Wisconsin in order to attend medical school. Another of his forms of therapy, this one more physically demanding, was tennis. The court built on his estate is still visible from Talent Road today. The next Sansum family members I met were his son, Donald, daughter-in-law, Virginia, and their sons, Armin, William, also known as Bud, and Stephen. Virginia, one of the classiest and prettiest ladies I ever met, and a former president of the Santa Barbara Women's Club, once hired me to build a toy train layout for Stephen. I also recall attending summer school with Bud at the Jefferson campus on the Riviera. We sometimes traveled there in a World War II vintage Jeep. The eldest grandson, Armin, also known as Herbie, and I began a close relationship during my high school years due to our mutual interest in antique cars and other historical artifacts. The only Model T Ford I ever drove was his 1915 brass radiator runabout, which he bought in Santa Barbara during the early 1950s and still has. Further, he was my personal downhill ski instructor at Yosemite when he was the public information officer for the National Park Service there. Lynn and I also spent time with him during his assignment at Lassen Volcanic National Park in Northern California. Our long-standing close relationship exists to this day. We are grateful that Dr. Sansum came to Santa Barbara because of his legacy of his continuing quest to help others in need. Thank you.
And I'm the third Burtness, and in about 3 minutes or so, I'm going to describe the time between approximately 1970 and the present. As you've already heard, Dr. Sansum was our father's mentor. And to honor that relationship, our father, sometime around 1970, decided he wanted to have a bust made of Dr. Sansum to put in the clinic reception area. Well, he found somehow a couple of artists, husband and wife, her name was Webster and his was Jensen, to do this. On the cover of Continuing Quest, which many of you have seen, and there's a copy back there in that display case, is the original bust of Dr. Sansum that our father commissioned. It's lost in history what happened to this clay model because it was never reproduced, it was never cast. So I actually called the wife after they left Santa Barbara in Idaho or Wyoming, I think it was, and I asked her what had ever happened to that, and she wasn't quite sure. He had died, so this was around 1970, as I say. And then our father died in 1983, and I picked up the trail a bit to try to find out what happened. One day I was looking at this book again, and here's this bust, 45 years old, not completed, and I said to myself, this deserves to be finished, not only to honor our father who started this, but obviously to honor Dr. Sansum. So one day I was talking with Joseph Bottoms, who's here this evening, about my objective, and did he know anyone who might be able to undertake this sculpture, to complete the sculpture, I should say. Well, he suggested a lady named Sue DiCicco, who is sitting here. And she, in fact, beginning about 2 years ago or so, recreated this very bust, the mold for it, had it cast at a foundry up in the Berkeley area, and it resides currently under this copper-colored cloth. And so we Burtness brothers are honored to be part of this program. We're honored to have the opportunity to present this bust of Dr. Sansum to Dr. Ransohoff and to his staff in the new clinic. And it will reside there sometime the next week or two after it's had its time here. So if my two brothers and Sue would step over here to this. Incidentally, the three of us have never seen this yet. It came here undercover. So the three of us and Sue are going to, Sue, if you'll pull the, yeah, that's fine. So we'll do that briefly and then we'll turn the meeting back over to Kurt Ransohoff for the conclusion.
Well, thank you to the Burtness brothers. That was just an amazingly kind and thoughtful gift to Sansum Clinic, and that will be very soon in the lobby of the what we call the Pueblo building right across from Cottage Hospital. So that really does conclude our talk tonight. I want to thank Dr. Daniel and Erin Graffy for giving us a tour of Santa Barbara medical history. That was great. Bobby Rosenblatt and Julie Nadell, once again, for hosting. And Warren Miller and the trustees here at the museum for allowing us to work with you on such a fun evening. There will be copies of the noticias signed, I believe, by our speakers and authors for everybody as they pass out to that. And hopefully you guys aren't going to actually pass out tonight as you walk out tonight. So again, thank you very much for coming, and good night.